Well, welcome to class, students. It's been a number of weeks now since we were last able to meet in this room and to study God's Word in the Heidelberg Catechism and to understand some of these basic doctrines. We really are living in unprecedented times. Your parents and your pastor, we haven't experienced days like this before where we've been hindered from going to church or going to school or going to catechism. And so these are unique days that we are experiencing. And it's in these days that I hope that God is teaching us more and more our dependence upon Him, and therefore our need for prayer. And that makes finishing our lessons on the Heidelberg Catechism all the more relevant, because if you recall, we are here in the last five lessons, and they all are dealing with prayer. We're looking at the Lord's Prayer. And so over the next few weeks, I want to finish up these lessons using this means of video. And we'll be looking at the importance of prayer, how to pray, and what to pray for. And we'll be doing so through these videos in which I will be presenting from a PowerPoint presentation. And so it should be easy for you to follow along. Well, students, as I mentioned in the introduction video, today we are looking at the Lord's Prayer and the second petition, and this is coming from the Heidelberg Catechism, Lord's Day 48. And so as we begin, I want to look in our Bibles at Luke 11, verses 1 to 4. This is just laying the groundwork again, reminding us that the Lord's Prayer doesn't happen in isolation, but there's a context to it. And so notice these words, Luke 11, verse 1 to 4. Now it came to pass, as Jesus was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, that one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. And so Jesus said to them, when you pray, say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us day by day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Well, it's the second petition that is our focus for this study. So let's ask the Lord for his blessing. Let's begin with prayer. Our Father, we thank you for this opportunity that you have given us to meet again and to study your word and to mine it for the deep riches and for the precious things that are contained in Scripture. Lord, we cannot meet in person right now, but we're thankful for the technology that allows us to meet virtually in this way. And so, Lord, we look to you and to your Spirit for his blessing now as we ask this question that the disciples asked. Lord, teach us to pray. And so, Lord, do that. Teach us to pray. Help us to know who we approach and to know what to pray for and how to pray. And, Lord, we pray that your word would have its life-changing effect on each of us in these difficult days. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want to begin our study with a little review, just getting us back, reminding us where we have gone in the past weeks, as it's been a number of weeks since we've been able to meet. And so first, notice the setting of this prayer. Notice how in Luke 11, verse 1, the disciples come to Jesus, they see him praying, and they want to reflect Christ's prayer life. They see that Christ has a vibrant prayer life. And so they say, Lord, teach us to pray. And that's a great question to be asking the Lord, to be praying, Lord, teach us to pray. And Jesus responds to that request by giving them the Lord's Prayer. And it's in Matthew 6, verse 9, where we see that Jesus says, in this manner, therefore, pray. And so notice that word manner. He says, in this manner, or in this way, you should pray. And so he's not saying that when you pray, you always need to use the exact words of the Lord's Prayer, but he's saying, I'm teaching you a model. Here's a model prayer. Here, I'm teaching you who you're approaching, how you're to approach him, and what you're to pray for. And so that's what we began to look at. Remember, we looked at the address. So we're praying to our Father who is in heaven. And there we saw that God is our Almighty Father through faith in Jesus Christ, and that we must approach him, therefore, in childlike reverence and trust. So reverence because he's in heaven, and yet trust because he's our Father. And then we looked at the first petition. Remember the word petition, it means request. So the first request. And the first request or petition was, hallowed be your name. Now, can you remember what we talked about under that first petition? What was the one word that really summarized that request? Well, if you think back and if you remember, then you remember the word is glory. There we're praying that God would be glorified. And we said, if you remember, that we're requesting that God would be glorified by us rightly knowing him, that is, having a saving relationship to him, by praising him for his works of creation, providence, and redemption, and living all of life in joyful obedience to him. Well, that's what we studied in the past weeks. You can always go back and look at those handouts that you have received at the end of each class, and there you'll find the short summary to what we looked at in those weeks. But what we're looking at today, then, is the second petition. And so the question is, well, what is the second petition? And I assume you know the answer to this. I assume that you know the Lord's Prayer. And so the second petition is, your kingdom come. Now, notice how short of a request that is. Just three words. Your kingdom come. And the key word that really sticks out is the word kingdom. This word kingdom. Now, it's a word we're all familiar with, of course. When we hear that word, maybe we think of the many great kingdoms of history, the kingdoms that have existed throughout the course of this world. If you like history, maybe you think of the Babylonian Empire, or the Assyrian Empire, the Persian Empire, or the Greek Empire, the Roman Empire. Those were the big kingdoms of the Bible. Those were the big kingdoms in the biblical times. But more recently, maybe you think of the British Empire, how the British Empire, it seemed to cover the whole globe. But with all earthly kingdoms, we need to realize that no matter how great they are, all earthly kingdoms come and go. We no longer see the Babylonian Empire or the Assyrian Empire or the Persian or the Greek or the Roman. And even the British Empire has dramatically weakened over the past decades and centuries. But while we say that, we also recognize that there is one kingdom that stands. There's one kingdom that has survived from the beginning of time and it will never be destroyed, and that is the kingdom of God, God's kingdom. Now, just think about Scripture, and I want you to think through the Bible, both Old and New Testament. Is there a passage that comes to mind that really teaches this point, that all of the kingdoms of the world, they fade away, but the kingdom of God, it lasts forever? Just pause and think for a moment. What Old Testament, maybe? What Old Testament story comes to mind? Well, the story I'm thinking of is found in Daniel chapter 2, verses 31 to 45. I encourage you to read that on your own time. Daniel 2, 31 to 45. And you'll remember that there, it's the story about Nebuchadnezzar's dream of the statue. You remember how Nebuchadnezzar dreams this dream of this great statue that's made of various elements or various metals. So it has a head of gold, and that is representing the kingdom of Babylon. And then as the statue goes down, there's a chest and arms made of silver, and that represents Persia, the empire that would follow after Babylon. And then there was the bronze belly and thigh, and that was Greece. Remember, Alexander the Great, he came and he defeated the Persians. And so he rose up as the next empire. And then there was the legs and the feet of iron and clay. And this was the Roman Empire, the empire that really dominated the world in the times of the New Testament. But remember in that story, in Daniel 2, in Nebuchadnezzar's dream, what happens to that statue? Well, there we find a stone cut without hands. It rolls towards this statue and it smashes it to the ground and totally obliterates it. And then that stone, it grows into a great mountain filling the earth. And that stone cut without hands is God's kingdom. And so the point is clear. Nebuchadnezzar, your kingdom will fade away, and all of these earthly kingdoms will fade away, but God's kingdom will triumph. And that leads us to the question then, well, what is the kingdom of God? What is the kingdom of God? It seems maybe somewhat theoretical. What are we talking about here? Are we talking about a place? You go maybe and you travel to this far off place where there's this realm and there's the kingdom of God? Well, that's actually not how the scripture describes things. The kingdom of God is his rule and reign over all things. So it's not so much a place, but it's God's power, his sovereign power that's ruling and reigning over all things. Scripture tells us that God is the great king of the universe. He's the creator. He's the holy king. And he created the world to make a kingdom for his son. You see that, for example, in Hebrews 1, verse 2, where it says God has given the world to his son, and his son, Jesus Christ, is the heir of all things, the inheritor of all things. He's the king that the Father is giving his kingdom to. And as we think about the kingdom of God, we recognize that this kingdom is not like other kingdoms. It's not a political kingdom or like the empires that we've been discussing already, like Babylon or Rome. But this kingdom is a spiritual, heavenly kingdom. In fact, if you read the New Testament, often the kingdom of God is also called the kingdom of heaven. It's two ways of describing the same thing. But also John 18, verse 36, there's Jesus on trial in front of Pontius Pilate. And Jesus says to him, "My kingdom is not of this world. My kingdom is a heavenly kingdom." Well, when did this kingdom begin? Well, it began in time with Adam and Eve as the first citizens in the garden. Looking at God as king and him establishing his kingdom, that's really a storyline that goes from the beginning of Scripture all the way to the very end. And it was there in Genesis 1 and 2 that God, as the king, makes Adam and Eve in his own image, and he sets them up as citizens in his kingdom. And really, he gives them a high position. Remember, he says, you are to have dominion over the rest of creation. And so God set up Adam and Eve really as vice regents or as stewards in his kingdom. But they were the first citizens of God's kingdom. But the story doesn't go on very long when, in fact, God's kingdom comes under attack. And that we see that in Genesis 3. There we find Satan coming through the serpent and deceiving Eve and Adam, of course, eating of the fruit of the tree together with Eve and plunging the human race into rebellion against God. And so there Satan established his kingdom of darkness. And Adam and Eve, they joined Satan's ranks. And so this is the tragedy that quickly enters the story. But right there in Genesis 3, God meets his people and he gives us a glorious gospel promise. It's the promise of the good news of the kingdom of God. Genesis 3, verse 15, God, he curses the serpent. And he says this, "And I will put my enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." And so this really is God cursing the serpent, but in this curse, there is an amazing promise of grace for sinners, for those who are God's people. And it, because in this curse on the serpent, notice what God is saying. He's saying, "I will put enmity between you and the woman." Right now, you and Eve and Adam, you are aligned together. You have made an alliance with Satan. But I am going to come. And so God promises here to fight Satan on behalf of his people. He's going to come and he's going to put warfare between the serpent and between the woman. He's going to break up their unholy alliance. And so God promises that he will enter the battle by taking on a human nature, by becoming a child of the woman. The seed of the woman is going to come. And he, the seed, the child, shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. And so here God is promising that Satan, the serpent, ultimately will have his head crushed. He will be destroyed. And while God will get the victory, notice how even there God says that his heel will be bruised in the process. And so there's going to be some sort of suffering that God is going to endure in this process of winning the victory. And as we find the promise of the seed, it unfolds throughout all of Scripture, and it continues from Genesis 3, and it goes on in Genesis 12 and 15 and 17 and 22, all of promises to Abraham, and it's promises that this seed is being narrowed from the seed of the woman, so from a human, down to a child of Abraham, and then to a child of Isaac, and then to a child of Jacob, and then to Judah, a child of Judah. Remember, the scepter will not depart from Judah. And then ultimately to King David. It's there in 2 Samuel 7, verses 12 to 14, where God promises David, "I will set up your seed after you, who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." And it's Galatians 3, verse 16, that where Paul says, "The seed is Christ." And so from the very beginning of time, there, right after the fall, Genesis 3, 15, all throughout the Old Testament, this promise of this seed, who would ultimately be a greater king than David was, who will have this eternal kingdom. He is coming, and Paul says, and the whole New Testament with him tells us, that this seed is Christ. Jesus Christ is the king who has conquered Satan through his suffering and resurrection into glory. This is what we just celebrated in Good Friday and Easter. There we saw the suffering servant, but also the victory of this servant. And today, Christ the King is expanding his kingdom and inviting all people into it. And that he does this through the proclamation of his word, so through the preaching, but also through his people sharing the gospel with others. And so Christ the King is busy today, right now, and he's building his kingdom and inviting all people into it. Well, that's the kingdom of God in a nutshell. But let's flesh it out. We still probably have a few questions in our mind. Well, what does this kingdom look like, and who are the citizens of the kingdom? Well, the true citizens of this kingdom are believers, and we know from Scripture that we enter this kingdom through repentance, so turning away from sin, and through faith. And not just faith generically, but through believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. So these are the true citizens of this kingdom, believers. But are those the only people involved in the kingdom of God? Now, maybe you think that's an obvious question to answer, but think with me of Scripture again. And here I'm thinking of the parable of the wheat and the tares. And remember how Jesus sets up that parable in Matthew 13, verse 24 to 43. And there he tells us that there are tares sprinkled in throughout the wheat. And this is a description of the kingdom of God. And so he's telling us that there are fake citizens in the kingdom as well. There are spies, you might think, in this kingdom who are actually belonging to the kingdom of darkness. And so these aren't true members of the kingdom, but these hypocrites, these people who are pretenders, they're part of the external kingdom of God, and yet they don't have the root of the matter in them. That is, they don't have repentance and faith in their life. But this is helpful for us to know. We need to keep in mind that, and you see that there in Matthew 13, that Jesus says, in this world, as Christ is building his kingdom, in the visible or external kingdom, there is a mixture of wheat and tares, of true believers and hypocrites. But the next question is, well, how is the kingdom related to the church? Is the kingdom the same thing as the church? When we speak about the kingdom of God, are we just thinking about God's church? And what we need to realize is that the visible church, so the church that we are a part of and all the other visible churches that are scattered throughout the world, the visible church is a vital part of the kingdom. But the kingdom of God includes any promotion of God's cause on earth. And so what we're saying is that, yes, the church is an essential part of the kingdom of God, but the kingdom of God is actually bigger than just the church. When you look in Scripture, you see this to be the case. And so the kingdom of God is any promotion of God's cause on earth. So maybe just off the top of your head, you can think of Christian schools, or Christian political parties, or Christian hospitals, or Christian counseling centers, or Christian nursing homes. And remember, we defined the kingdom of God as God's rule and reign. And so it's not limited to the church, but the kingdom of God is anywhere we see God's truth, his righteousness, his justice, and his grace spreading. When we see that, his truth, so his word, in schools or in politics, then we're seeing the kingdom of God. And so just think, where can you see the kingdom of God? Well, you can see it at your home. You can witness the kingdom of God at your home when God's word is being obeyed, when his truth is being loved, you are living as a subject of the king by following God's word. Or you can see it at school or at work. And so what an amazing way to live life is by recognizing that there is this great battle going on between the kingdom of darkness on the one hand and the kingdom of God on the other. And that this is unfolding in all of the ordinary and mundane things of life, that this is going on when you're at school or at home or at work. Everywhere in this world where people are submitting to God, the king and his good laws, then that's where the kingdom of God is growing. And so just to, again, clarify, the church is an essential part of God's kingdom, but it's not the whole of the kingdom. But the church, it's the tool that God uses to bring sinners into his kingdom, so often through the preaching of the gospel or through the evangelizing of the church members. And it's where God's people are equipped to be active in the kingdom. And so the church isn't the kingdom, it's just a part, but it's a vital part of the kingdom of God. And so in summary then, this is really all laying the groundwork for understanding this prayer. But in summary, Jesus Christ has inaugurated or established his kingdom on earth with his life, death, and resurrection, where he triumphed over Satan. And so his ultimate victory is guaranteed. But we are still waiting for the final consummation, when Christ will have gathered in the last of his elect people and will return to rule with his people forever. And so that's where we live. We live in this in-between period. And it's in this time, in this period, that Jesus wants us to pray for his kingdom to come. And so that's what we are focused on doing in this Lord's Day. We're looking at this request, let your kingdom come. And so here we are looking at Lord's Day 48. Question 123, what is the second petition? The answer is, your kingdom come. That is, so rule us by your word and spirit that more and more we submit to you, preserve and increase your church, destroy the works of the devil, every power that raises itself against you, and every conspiracy against your holy word. Do all this until the fullness of your kingdom comes, wherein you shall be all in all. Well, maybe that sounds like a mouthful to you, so I've broken it down here for you. What are we praying for? Well, we're praying your kingdom come. And what does that mean? Well, we'll see three things. First, so rule us by your word and spirit that more and more we submit to you. That's the first request, first thing we're praying for. Second, preserve and increase your church. Third, destroy the works of the devil, every power that raises itself against you, and every conspiracy against your holy word. And then the conclusion of this request is, do all this until the fullness of your kingdom comes, wherein you shall be all in all. And so as we continue in this lesson, I want to just take a few moments reflecting on all three of those requests. So first, rule us. That's what we're praying. So rule us by your word and spirit that more and more we submit to you. And so notice that. Maybe you've prayed the Lord's Prayer hundreds of times and you've said, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. And it sounds so theoretical. It sounds so out there, so distant. Lord, build your kingdom. But it seems, you know, way off way out in the distance. But here the Catechism helps us that it really starts with me. As I'm praying this request, I'm praying, Lord, give me the grace to submit to you. Rule me. And this tells us something about who we are by nature, because by nature we want to be our own kings. That is, we want to rule our own lives and to set up our own kingdoms. We do this every time we sin. We are going against God's law and we're asserting our own law. I have my own way of thinking. I want to do things my way. And so what I'm saying is I want to be king or I want to be queen over my own life. But when we're praying this request, we're praying that all of my life would be in submission to God. Lord, give me the grace to submit to you. And notice that there are two means that the Lord uses to work this submission in us and thereby to rule over us. And these are the means of his word and his spirit. And so this tells us that I must be listening to the word preached and studying it for myself and then praying for the spirit to apply it to me. So we need to do stuff like this, where we're studying God's word and we're trying to dig deeper into what does it mean when Jesus says, pray, your kingdom come. Well, that's what we're doing. We're studying God's word, but also we put ourselves under the preaching of the word and we do devotions, we do maybe family worship. But with all of these good times in God's word, we also need to be praying for the Spirit to apply it. We need the Spirit to bear his fruit in our life and to make the word powerful and fruitful as we live it out. And so we're first of all praying, Lord, rule over us. by your word and spirit, that more and more we may submit to you. And so notice that. It's a process in the Christian's life. It's more and more. And Romans 7 really describes the warfare that continues internally in the believer, that there is this, that there are these enemies inside that are rising up. And you can think of pride that rises up, and it needs to be killed. It needs to be cut down. And these are enemies that are hindering me from submitting to God. And so this is a process in the Christian's life where God uses his word and his spirit to more and more help us to submit to him. Well, second then, we are praying, build your church. So first, rule over us, but second, build your church. We see that, preserve and increase your church. Now this word preserve, it means to keep or protect or maintain. And in this word preserve, maybe your mind, you think of preservatives. You're thinking maybe of food, and preservatives are added to the food to protect it from decaying. And so this word, it communicates the idea of protection and maintenance. And it tells us that the church is under attack. There are enemies inside the church. There's false teaching in the church. There's spiritual deadness in the church. And so there's enemies inside the church that God needs to preserve his church from. And there are enemies outside the church. There's persecution. And ultimately, behind all of these attacks is Satan himself. And so when we're praying this, preserve and increase your church, we're praying, Lord, protect your church from all of these different attacks, those coming within and without. But also increase your church. And that word has the idea of to expand or to grow. And so we're praying here that God would increase the number of converts, but also increase the holiness of his people. And so notice that we're praying that the Lord would build his church in terms of the numbers, the quantity, but also in terms of the quality, that he would increase the spiritual life of his people. This is what we've been really praying for on Saturdays. Lord, revive us again. Cause your church to awaken and to be made alive. And so, yes, we're praying for more conversions, but we're also praying for greater holiness in God's people, in us. And so, let your kingdom come. First, rule over us. Second, build your church. But third, destroy your enemies. And so, here we see the Catechism says, destroy the works of the devil, every power that raises itself against you, and every conspiracy against your holy word. And this word destroy, it means to tear down or to conquer. And so we're praying, Lord, destroy everything that opposes you. So we're not praying for tolerance or just for niceness to flourish in the world, but we're praying actually this battle prayer. We're praying that God would crush his enemies and destroy every power that rises against him. When we're praying this, we're recognizing how evil Satan is. And we're recognizing how wrong sin is, that it is lawlessness, that it is an attack against God. And we're recognizing how wrong then all of God's enemies are, and how they need to be destroyed by God. And so some of the enemies, well, this includes false teaching, persecution, or worldliness even in our lives. We're praying that God would tear down, that he would conquer anything that is in opposition to him. Well, those are the three things we're praying for. In the three words, your kingdom come, notice that. First, we're praying, Lord, rule over us. So it's concerning us. Second, Lord, build your church. So we're praying for the growth of the church and the building up of the church. And then third, destroy your enemies. So Lord, we're really looking here into the world and we're praying, Lord, may your kingdom triumph over all of your enemies in this world. And then finally, there's the consummation. Notice how the Heidelberg Catechism closes. Do all this until the fullness of your kingdom comes, wherein you shall be all in all. And so here we are praying for the fullness of God's kingdom to come. And this fullness comes in the consummation. Now that's a big word that means the fulfilling of the wrapping up of all of God's purposes. And this happens when Christ will be openly acknowledged as king by everyone. And this, of course, happens when Christ returns again. Jesus has come the first time. He's lived. He's died. He's rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven. And right now he's seated on the throne at the right hand of the Father. And he's waiting, as Psalm 110 says, for his enemies to be made his footstool. But there's a final act that we are waiting for. And that is for Christ to return again. And my friends, this is going to be the best day for every true member of the kingdom. This is going to be the best day for everyone who loves their king. Because finally, King Jesus will come back and we will see him and he will have all authority and all of the things that are bad in this world, he's going to push them away and they're forever going to be banished and destroyed. And all that's good is going to flourish. And so this is the best day for every true member of the kingdom, for everyone who loves their king. Finally, they will be in his presence and enjoy perfect communion with him. His kingdom will have come, and we will, all who are Christ, will be reigning with him then forever. But this is also the worst day for those who oppose the king. This is the day when the king and the judge returns and has his final victory over all of his enemies, over everyone who hasn't submitted to him in this life, who hasn't responded to his grace. This will be the worst day because they will be banished into the eternal flames of hell. And they will be rightly judged for their rebellion against the king. And so, which one of these groups do you find yourself in? Are you a true member of this kingdom? One who loves this king and who has responded to him and daily responds to him in repentance and faith? Or are you one who opposes this king or maybe is, yes, a part of the visible kingdom of God, but not a true member, a true citizen? Well, if that's the case, then turn to this king. It's still the day of grace. He is still building his church. He's still welcoming sinners into his ranks. And so, while this is the consummation, do all of this until the fullness of your kingdom comes, wherein you shall be all in all. And so when we pray, let your kingdom come, we are really praying, ultimately, come, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Return again. Wrap up all of your work and return on the clouds of heaven. And so, in summary, I want to give you the main point of this lesson. The main point really wraps up everything that we've been seeing in this second petition is that the second petition requests that God would increasingly rule over us, build his church, and defeat his enemies until Christ comes again to bring in the fullness of his kingdom. Well, that is the close of our lesson for this week. Let us now go to our King in prayer. King Jesus, we come to you at the close of this time together in your word, and we're thankful for what you have revealed here. And Lord, we pray that this would be the prayer in all of our hearts. Let your kingdom come. Lord, may we be able to pray this in truth. that you would rule over each of us, that you would build your church, that you would defeat and destroy your enemies, and do this until the fullness of time when you come again on the clouds. Come, Lord Jesus, come quickly. We pray this in your name. Amen.